Remember your mercy, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servant, for whom Christ, your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the Paschal mysteries, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the sons of man. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before the Lord like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others shall hide their faces, he was despised. And we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. Each has turned to their own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh. seek refuge. Do not let me ever be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me. Into your hand I commit my spirit. You have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Scorn of all my adversaries, a horror to my neighbors, an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the street flee from me. I have passed out of mind like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
obedient for us to death, even death on a cross. Therefore God exalted him and gave him the name above every name.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to John. After they had eaten the supper, Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers, together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again, he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
"Jesus of Nazareth."
"I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter,
"You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?"
Peter said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying,
"Is that how you answer the high priest?"
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him,
"You're not also one of his disciples, are you?"
He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
"Did I not see you in the garden with him?"
Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
"What accusation do you bring against this man?"
They answered,
"If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you."
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
They replied,
"We are not permitted to put anyone to death."
This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?
Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?"
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?"
"My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here."
"So you are a king."
"You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
"What is truth?"
After he had said this, Pilate went out to the Jews again and told them,
"I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
They shouted in reply,
"Not this man, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him."
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and a purple robe. Pilate said to them,
"Here is the man."
When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him."
They answered him,
"We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he has claimed to be the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
"Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and power to crucify you?"
"You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin."
From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. Pilate said to the Jews,
"Here is your king."
They cried out,
"Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
We have no king but the emperor.
Then Pilate handed Jesus over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the people read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but this man said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic, and the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another,
"Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, and see who will get it."
This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother,
"Woman, here is your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Here is your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, in order to fulfill the scripture, he said,
"I am thirsty."
A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
May we rise.
Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, and he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 weight. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
My dear friends in Christ, today we celebrate Good Friday, the day our Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross to save us all. And the cross today becomes the emphasis of the day. The cross and the crucifix are meaningful symbols, as the dove symbolizes peace and the heart symbolizes love. The crucifix and the cross are the symbols of the loving and the sacrificial offerings of Christ for us. It is in the cross that we see the face of God's love. The cross is the symbol of the remission of our sins. In Isaiah 53, verse 5, the Bible says, "He was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed." The cross is the symbol of humility and the self-emptying of others. The cross is the symbol of the risen Christ, who promises us a crown of glory as a reward for our patience. Christ was the first to carry his cross to die for us all. Therefore, we all should carry our crosses willingly to follow Christ. However, cross bearing is a condition for Christian discipleship. In Matthew 16:24, Jesus said, "Whoever wishes to come after me must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." It is by carrying our crosses that we make reparation for our sins and for the sins of others related to us. That is why St. Paul says that he was suffering in his body what is lacking in Christ's suffering. It is by carrying our crosses that we become imitators of Christ in his sufferings for us. In Galatians 2:19, St. Paul says, "I have been crucified with Christ, yet I live, no longer I, but Christ lives in me." Our lessons today: we should carry our crosses with the right disposition and motive, with sacrificial love and dedicated commitment, drawing strength and inspiration from Christ. We should plant our cross as Christ in our daily lives. We have to begin every day with the sign of cross, asking the blessings and protection of the crucified Lord in our lives every day. And today, my dear friends in Christ, as we celebrate the death of Christ on the cross, may we continue to ask for his intercession in our lives, as we prepare ourselves for this moment of silence today. May the good Lord continue to bless our hearts as we listen to his words. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her, and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God, the Father Almighty. We pray to the Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ reveal your glory to all the nations, watch over the work of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith and confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the people, the Christian people, governed by your merit, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Bishop Marcel, his auxiliary Bishop Yvan, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose spirit the whole body of the church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness for all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Almighty ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offerings, increase the faith and understanding of our catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased, as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bonds of charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayer of your church, that the people you first made your own may attend the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that, enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mysteries of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Almighty ever-living God, who created our people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you, come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good work done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of all human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hands lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secured, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayer of those who cry out in any tribulations come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand through Christ our Lord.
just a few minutes, we'll be invited to come forward to venerate the cross. We'll follow the same pattern that we do for the reception of Holy Communion. So for those of you who are in the two center sections, we'll come by the two center aisles to venerate the cross, and then you'll return to your pews by the aisles with the pillars. For those of you who are on either side, there will be a cross on each section here. Again, you'll come by the aisle with the windows. Everybody's returning by the aisle with the pillars. For those of you who are downstairs, a cross will come down in just a moment. A reminder that the cross is venerated by a profound bow or genuflection. Thank you. Please stand.
Oh.
Please stand.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold he who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy for you to enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
Once again, those of you in the center aisles, please come up the center aisle and return to your pews by the pillars. For those of you on both sides by the windows or coming up by the windows, everybody's returning by the aisles with the pillars. A reminder for those of you who choose to receive the Eucharist in the hand, that it is consumed in the presence of the person who gives it to you. Please do not walk away with the Eucharist. Thank you. Michael, if you can go over there. If you can go over there.
Body of Christ. 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 Body of Christ.
anybody.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of these mysteries, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord. Bow down your heads for God's blessings. May the abundant blessings, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secured through Christ our Lord.